Good morning, CUMC. Jake Waybright here, one of the pastors at the church, and I'm so glad to join you in worship this morning. I'm praying that this will be an experience that connects you both to God's Spirit and helps you give you perspective for your whole week ahead. As we come into worship, a reminder that you can print out the interactive worship guide to participate with prayers and other things throughout the service. And I want to share with you a few things of what's coming up in the life of our congregation and ways that you can be connected. First of all, a reminder that as construction moves forward at our new church, that we are going to be paving the parking lot over the coming weeks. And so there will be no drive-in worship on Sunday, August 9th or Sunday, August 16th. We'll be having just this online worship experience together. We'll be our worship option for those 2 weeks. And we're hoping if the paving goes well, we'll be back to drive-in worship on the 23rd. Also on the 23rd, we are having an exciting sneak peek of our new church, and that'll be in the afternoon from 1 p.m. to 5 p.m. You can sign up online on our website to come and get a half-hour tour. It'll be a guided tour in very small groups with masks in a way to keep everyone safe, but an opportunity to walk through and to pray about our move to the new church. I hope you go and sign up to be a part of that. And then also, if you missed the announcement over the last 2 weeks, our reopening team has made the decision with the rising cases of COVID and with the restrictions on gatherings that we aren't going to have a regathering Sunday worship experience at this church, our current facility, before we move to Spring Garden. We know that for some of you, you would really like to be able to have the opportunity. It's important for you to be able to have the opportunity to be in the building again and to say farewell. And so in the next week, why don't you pay attention to the midweek moment and look on the website. We're going to have some opportunities on Sunday, August 30th for you to come into the building to pray together, to maybe take some pictures, and to say farewell to this place where you have experienced God's presence so many times. Well, those are some of the things coming up in the life of our congregation. I invite you and remind you to take a look at our website. There's the most updated information is there, and to sign up for a midweek moment if you haven't, where you can keep connected to all the things that are happening here at CUMC. The building might be closed, but the church has never stopped. As we come into worship this morning, I'm going to invite you as we come into worship to prepare our hearts and our minds to worship with an opening prayer. Would you just open your hands, palms up, as we pray together? Most holy God, we await the touch of your Spirit with eagerness. We ask that you enter each of our lives this day as we come to worship you as the Father who loves us, the Son who saves us, and the Spirit who lives with us. Refresh, renew, and heal us with the power of your loving Spirit, that we may live with purpose, joy, and courage in the way of Jesus. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, turn your attention as we come into worship to the ministry of music, Fount of Blessings. Thank you. Hi kids, it's Pastor Jake, and I'm here for today's children's chat. I'm here outside in my backyard for this chat because I want you to do something here. I want you to stop and listen. What do you hear? You hear birds, yeah. Maybe the leaves rustling. Maybe some other noises in the background. Do you know, anytime that I'm outside, one of the things that I like to do when I'm out in nature is just to stop and to listen, to hear the sounds of the animals and the birds and the wind and maybe the water that's all around me. This is one of the ways that I feel connected to God. And in the same way, when we stop and in our own life and pray, that's what one of the ways that we get to listen for God's still small voice. You know, there was a man named Elijah once who wanted to hear from God, and he went out on a mountain. And when he went out on the mountain, he stopped, and at first he heard loud thunder and lightning, but God wasn't in that big noise. And then he heard fire and earthquake, but God wasn't in that noise either. And then suddenly Elijah, when he stopped and was very quiet, heard a still, quiet whisper. And that was God's voice speaking to him. In the same way, when we stop and are quiet in prayer, this is how we begin to learn to feel God's love for us, to sense God that God is with us, and to begin to hear God nudging us and leading us in our lives to be the people that God wants us to be. So this week, I want you to find ways to just stop and listen. Stop and listen to the things around you, maybe in your backyard, and stop and listen in prayer to God, who is always there and always loves you. All right, would you pray with me? God, we thank you for who you are, and we thank you that when we stop and listen in prayer, that you are always there to meet us. We love you, God, and thank you for sending your son, Jesus, so that we would always know how much you love us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, kids. I hope you have a great week, and I hope you find some time to stop and listen. Bye.
The book of Acts tells the story of the spread of the early church after Jesus' resurrection. In the first few chapters of Acts, we read about the day of Pentecost. This is the day, 50 days after Jesus' resurrection, when the disciples were filled with the presence of the Holy Spirit. Their experience of God's Spirit living in them and abiding with them continues throughout the rest of the book of Acts. God's presence with them is clearly their source of wisdom, power, and peace. Jesus, before he ascends into heaven, promises their presence and gives them one clear command: wait for it. Just wait for it. Hear now Jesus' instructions and the response of the disciples as they paused to pray. From the first chapter of Acts, verses 1 through 5 and 12 through 14. In my former book, Theophilus, I wrote about all that Jesus began to do and teach until the day he was taken up to heaven and giving instructions through the Holy Spirit to the apostles he had chosen. After his suffering, he presented himself to them and gave them many convincing proofs that he was alive. He appeared to them over a period of 40 days and spoke about the kingdom of God. On one occasion, while he was eating with them, he gave them this command: do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised, which you have heard me speak about. For John baptized with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit. Then the apostles returned to Jerusalem from the hill called the Mount of Olives, a Sabbath day's walk from the city. When they arrived, they went upstairs to the room where they were staying. Those present were Peter, John, James, and Andrew, Philip and Thomas, Bartholomew and Matthew, James, son of Alphaeus, and Simon the Zealot, and Judas, son of James. They all joined together constantly in prayer, along with the women and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and with his brothers. Two other readings for today are from the Psalms. These two Psalms both remind us that our strength, our joy, our souls rest in God's presence. From Psalm 16, verses 8 and 11, I keep my eyes always on the Lord. With him at my right hand, I will not be shaken. You make known to me the path of life. You will fill me with joy in your presence and with eternal pleasures at your right hand. And from Psalm 62, verses 1 and 2, trust, truly my soul finds rest in God. My salvation comes from him. Truly he is my rock and my salvation. He is my fortress. I will never be shaken. May God, by the power of the Spirit, add a blessing to the reading, the hearing, and the living of these words. Amen.
Thank you, Chris, for that scripture that reminds us of the power of prayer in the lives of the early disciples. We turn our attention now in worship to a time of prayer, and as we do today, I want to share just a few things that we're going to incorporate in our prayer time. One is just that this week is a weekend in which we honor our celebrate our scholarship recipients. You know, CUMC has always been a church of extravagant generosity, supporting our mission of inviting all to become disciples, giving so that our community is better because we are here, and investing in the lives of children and youth. We've been blessed for many years to be able to give scholarships to students attending higher education because of funds given by many families over the years. This year, we're able to give funds from 6 different scholarship funds to 13 different students, totaling $16,300. Thank you to the families who continue to support the scholarship fund and bless our students in higher education. Here are the students that are going to receive the scholarships this year. And for the ones that we have, the information of where they'll be attending in the fall. Cody Breon, a junior at Roanoke College. Nathan Fogelsanger, a sophomore at York College. Devin Greenwood, a senior at Kutztown University. Trevor Greenwood, a freshman at Shippensburg University. Emily Kearns will be a junior at Penn State. Gloria Kim will be a junior at the University of Rochester. Wyatt Morrison will be a freshman at Lebanon Valley College. Najee Nickerson has received one of the scholarships. Joshua Reynolds. Faith and Lisa Sale will both be freshmen at Elizabethtown College. Andrew Stafford will be a freshman at the Pennsylvania College of Technology. Mark Stafford will be a senior at Penn State University. And Jenny Stauffer will be attending Wilson College. If you get to see these scholarship recipients, send them words of thanks and encouragement as they start this new school year, this year in probably different ways, maybe virtually this year, and to encourage them as they continue their journey and to give thanks for all that God has already done for them. Thank you, CUMC, for your continued generosity that we use to bless children and youth as they grow up to be disciples of Jesus. We're going to include those folks in our prayer time today. And also, as we can come to our prayer time, we want to remember some of the prayer concerns in our congregation. First of all, a few people who are recovering from illness, Sue Baxter, Susan Slopey, and Maisie Godfrey. We also remember a few folks connected to our congregation who are going through cancer treatments, Nancy, the great aunt of Leah Garrett, and Brenda Jumper's cousin. And finally, we have our sympathies to the family of Ann Cook and to Tony Breon and his family on the death of his father. And finally, to John Wakefield and family on the death of his brother. As we come to this time of prayer, we remember that our souls indeed do find their rest in God's presence. Let's go to God in a time of prayer. And as we prepare to pray, we'll center our hearts through the ministry of music. God, in the goodness of your presence, we find rest and joy and peace and courage and direction. God, today as we come together worship, we pray. We pray for those scholarship recipients who are headed back to school. We pray that you would continue to be with them, to form and to shape them into the people that you have called them to be. And God, we pray not only for them, but we pray for all students who are preparing to go back to school in unusual and difficult circumstances. For those who are going back to virtual learning, or for parents who are homeschooling their children this year or cyberschooling. For teachers who are preparing to go back and teach in a way that they never had before. God, for all students and educators and folks involved in the education of our children and for families making decisions, we pray for your guidance and your peace to be with them. God, this morning we also come to pray for those others in our community. We pray for all of those who are recovering from illness, those mentioned this morning and others who we come now before you with on our hearts. We pray for an assurance of your presence and for a strengthening from day to day as they recover. God, we also continue to pray for those who are going through treatments. We pray for the doctors and nurses who are working with them. We pray for safety, and we pray that you would work with the doctors and with the bodies to bring healing and strength from day to day. And God, we pray with those who grieve. We know, God, that we do not grieve alone, but that you have put us into community that we might find strength among one another, and that you give us the gift of your Spirit to comfort us in our time of grief. God, we pray that you would be with those who are grieving, giving them strength and a hope of a future and the promise of the future with you. And God, today we also come to pray for our world. God, we pray for our world in a time in which the news can seem overwhelming. All of the different, all of the uncertainty, all of the polarization. God, we pray for your peace. God, we pray that we might be able to keep our minds centered on you. And we pray, God, that in the midst of uncertain times, that you may show us what it means to live like your son Jesus, who brought calm to whatever storms he encountered, who brought healing to wherever he found brokenness, who brought peace to those with whom he spent time. We pray, God, that in all things, we may not only know your peace for ourselves, but we may be those who shine your light and your love and your hope and your joy and your peace to those places in which we are called, in our families, in our workplaces, in our neighborhoods, and in our corners of the world. We pray this in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray this prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Amen. Well, today as we continue in worship, we come to the time of reflecting on the scriptures today in the sermon. And we're starting a new series that we are calling Abide, Abide, Finding Rest. In the last week or two, I've had this sense among those who I've interacted with, and not everyone, but many people, of a kind of fatigue, that many of us are feeling tired. The news of the continuing COVID cases, the polarization on our social media feeds, the constantly changing landscape that makes it challenging to plan anything past today, and many decisions that we have to make that none of us have had to make before. When in the midst of all of this, there is a heaviness that can easily settle in, and a fatigue, a tiredness. Are you feeling tired this week? I was talking last week with another pastor who's this highly effective, decisive leader who has always been a very confident decision maker. And he said, you know, I found myself this week thinking about it. And he said, I feel uncertain about every single decision that I have to make. There's just this general sense of not feeling like I can rest in any of my decisions. And he said, I've never felt like this before in my whole life. And it's exhausting. There are habits that we have that actually can feed the fatigue and the tiredness in us. One of those habits that's gotten a little bit of news in the last month is something called doom scrolling. It's a slang term for the habit of getting on the news or social media or the web and binging on one doom and gloom story after another, literally choosing to dwell or live or stay in the stories of how hard things are, until we find ourselves swimming in a pool of despair or heaviness. In one NPR story about this, mental health practitioners have explained that our mind is naturally geared to look for threats. It's a healthy thing in us. But the more time that we spend scrolling, the more we find those dangers, and then the more that we get sucked into them, and the more anxious that we get. The grim content, the mental health experts said, can throw a dark filter over how we see everything in the world in our lives. And all of a sudden, you look around yourself, and everything feels gloomy, everything makes you anxious, and then you go back to look at more information, and the cycle continues. Have any of you caught yourself in this kind of cycle in the last few months? In a story from NPR, they gave three habits that can help you break the cycle. Set a timer when you find yourself stuck in doom scrolling and say, I'm going to do this for 15 minutes and then I'm getting off. Stay aware or cognizant of why you're on and what information you actually need to get. And get off when you're done with that. And then the final piece of advice they give is to swap the vicious cycles that bring us despair and tiredness and heaviness for virtuous cycles. Swap vicious cycles for virtuous cycles. This means making time for the things that bring energy, joy, and hope to you. In other words, choose how you will use your moments to choose where you dwell and live in things that bring you life. Now, as a follower of Jesus, I'm reminded in this time that the resources and habits that we have as followers of Jesus are probably more important than ever. Because much of living like Jesus is actually learning to develop the habits that Jesus practiced and taught. Because the habits that Jesus practiced and taught create a kind of virtuous cycle in our lives. They restore us, they give us rest, they help us to live in a land of generosity and hope and perspective and power. Over the next few weeks, I want us to think about and renew our habits that point towards this, around this idea, this theme of abiding. What are the habits or things that we can put in our life that create this virtuous cycle of abiding in God, abiding in Christ, and allowing the Spirit to abide in us? Abide is an interesting word. It's not a word that we use very often. Two of the definitions are to remain in a certain state or to live in a place. Some of the synonyms, if you look in a thesaurus, are words like, for abide, are words like inhabit, reside, nest, perch, dwell, stay, hang out, settle, or to persist, or remain, or last, or to keep on in a certain place or state. Jesus promised us at the end of the book of John that we can abide in God and in Him just as He abided in the Father, in the presence of peace and power. I want to offer a definition, my own definition of abide, that we're going to use for this sermon series. And that definition is this: abiding is the action in the moment, in any moment, of intentionally remaining present to God, to ourselves, and others. Let me say that again. Abiding is the action in the moment of intentionally remaining present to God, ourselves, and others. It's that choice to live in this moment, to live in these relationships, and the truth is, it takes practice. It takes persistence. And it takes time. But this learning to put into place this virtuous cycle that leads to a life of abiding has great power and a great promise for us. People as early as the psalmist understood the gift and the habit of abiding with God. We just heard some verses from the Psalms today on this, and you could find many more scattered throughout the Psalms. From Psalm 16, I keep my eyes always on the Lord, right? So this is how the psalmist describes his habit of abiding, what he's doing to abide. I keep my eyes always on the Lord. With Him at my right hand, I will not be shaken. And then the promise, you make known to me the path of life. So this is direction. You fill me with joy in your presence. You receive joy in abundance with eternal pleasures at your right hand. Or from Psalm 62, verses 1 to 2, a psalm of David, truly my soul finds rest in God. It reminds me of Jesus in Matthew chapter 11. It says, all who are weary, come to me and find rest for your soul. Truly my soul finds rest in God. My salvation comes from him. So here's what I want to propose to you as we begin this series on abiding, about the virtuous cycle and habits that might help us to abide in God's presence that promises direction, that promises joy, that promises rest for our souls. That this series may be one of the most important things that you consider as we continue to wade through the coming months of this pandemic. This idea of abiding may be the one thing that gets you through all that is to come in the year ahead like nothing else. I think that if we could learn and grow in our practice of abiding with God, that abiding in God's presence so that God's presence might abide in us, that it can make all the difference for weary souls and lost perspective. Now, to get us started today on those practices of abiding this week, I want us to think about this passage that we heard Chris read to us from the book of Acts. Think about these as some of Jesus' last instructions. After Jesus' resurrection, he appeared to the disciples for about 6 weeks, give or take, 40 days in his resurrected body. He taught them, he forgave them for their betrayal, he reminded them that they had a wonderful purpose, that they were going to share the good news of God's love in Jesus to everyone in the entire world. And now that they had seen a man come back from the dead, they no longer had to fear. And Luke tells them he gave them one other instruction. They had all this work to do, all of these things, all of these grand purposes that they were going to accomplish. And then he gave them one instruction. Wait. Wait. Their instructions were not to get on it, to get busy, to read all the news, to make a 5-point strategic plan about how they were going to live out this mission, but to wait, to pause until he literally would breathe life into them. They had to stop, to pause, to wait. You heard this in the reading from Chris, right? Do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my Father promised, which you have heard me speak about. For John baptized with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit. Wait, he says. Pause, and then you'll get everything you need. It made me think of an anonymous quote or poem that I had read a few years ago that says this. It says, practice the pause. When in doubt, pause. When angry, pause. When tired, pause. When stressed, pause. And when you pause, pray. Practice the pause. I love this reminder, and this has been a reminder, a phrase that I've used and reminded myself in my own prayer life. When you pause, pray, and that is exactly what those early followers of Jesus did. They went back to Jerusalem, and they practiced the pause, and in their pause, they prayed together in that upper room. Did you notice that they all joined together constantly in prayer? I don't know about you, but sometimes I don't always practice the pause. How good are you at practicing the pause? I'm not always good at waiting. I was telling someone recently about a time in college. I was a college student, and we were on this retreat, and at this retreat center, there was a pond, and in the pond, there were canoes and rowboats and paddle boats, and we could take rides on it. And we were getting ready to leave from the retreat center, and two of my friends had gotten into a canoe, one in the front, one in the back, and there was a space in the middle for one more person. As they began to pull out from the dock with their canoe for one more ride around the lake before we got in the vans and headed back to campus, I thought in a moment, I'd like to be in that canoe with them, and I think I can make it in. At this point, they were probably 2 or 3 feet away from the dock and paddling. So all of a sudden, I looked out and I said, "Prepare to be boarded." And I ran and I took this running jump. I got 1 foot out, and then I realized the mistake that I had made. I was never going to get all in that canoe. I got 1 foot in, and the other foot was hanging in the water. Well, you can imagine what happened very soon after that. 1 foot in, 1 foot out, and pretty soon the whole canoe flipped over, and my friends and myself on this cold October day were all ankle deep in the muck on the bottom of the pond up to our waists. They didn't even know what had happened to them. And on that October day, I wished I would have practiced the pause. If I would have paused even for just a few seconds, I would have remembered that I have one of the shortest jumps of anybody I know, and there was no way that I would have made it into that canoe. But I didn't practice the pause. In the moment, I just saw it and I went for it. Some days, it kind of feel like that moment at that retreat. The day gets running full steam. I've got stuff to do, emails to send, people to call, meetings and appointments, and I'm off. And half the day, I feel like I've got 1 foot in and 1 foot out. In some moments, I don't practice the pause in my day. In a conversation, I might be angry or offended, and it feels like as I respond without pausing first, like we all just ended up in the muck of a pond. And when I do wait, sometimes in that pause, what I do is overthink or worry. Instead of trusting that in the pause I might be able to rest in God's presence, I worry. I try and figure it out on my own. And instead of being able to find strength, perspective, relief, direction, courage, power from the God of the universe, I get stuck in my own head, earthbound. Peter, Andrew, James, and John, Mary's and the other women and some 120 others, they had been taught what they were needed to do, and they knew what they were supposed to do, but before they did it, they were given this final instruction: wait, practice the pause. And here's what's key about that moment of Pentecost when the Holy Spirit filled them and directed them and would lead them throughout the rest of the book of Acts. It was in the pause that came the power. It was in the pause that came the power. Before they could do as Jesus' disciples, they had to pause as Jesus' disciples. And it's in this that we find that the Christian life is not done simply with a little more determination, with a little more getting a little better at following the rules or pulling yourself together. The Christian life is not found when we dwell constantly in the things around us, the problems around us. We live in this world of turmoil in our minds. The Christian life is a life where we dwell in the pause and are filled with the Spirit, the power of the Spirit. It may not look as dramatic as those first Christians, but it's available to all followers of Jesus. As Paul invited us to learn to grow into the habit of praying without ceasing, that's another way of saying to abide always in the constant presence of God, finding direction and strength and peace. You see, a life without a pause, without the pause, is a life without the power and life of God. A life without the pause is a life without the power and life of God. This is true not only in those big moments when we first experience the Spirit, but in those little moments of our day. Practicing the pause makes a world of difference. It allows us to take the time to stay calm, relax, and more importantly, to be present and wait on God, in whom is joy, in whom is purpose, in whom is peace. And I've found in my own life and the lives of those around us that learning to practice the pause, to structure your days and your weeks around the pause, is one of the keys to abiding in God's presence. I mean, think about it. Have you ever thought about how often Jesus paused? After his baptism, he goes into the wilderness for 40 days in silence and solitude and prayer and fasting. He practiced the pause. When the demands of others and the brokenness of the world pressed in on him, where do we so often find him when the disciples are saying, there are all these things that need your attention, all this brokenness? We find him sitting on a hillside alone, praying, practicing the pause. When he was about to pick his 12 disciples, he stayed up all night praying by himself. He practiced the pause. When he turned his face towards Jerusalem, he went up on a mountain where God's presence was so powerful that Peter and James and John saw him shining with God's glory. He practiced the pause. In the hours before his arrest on Thursday night and his trial, he paused at the Garden of Gethsemane to pray. He practiced the pause. You see, to study the secret of Jesus' life and to live with him is to see that the practicing of the pause was one of the secrets to Jesus' ability to abide in God's presence. Where, as the disciples found courage, power, and guidance, and as the psalmist said, fullness of joy and rest for our souls was found. When was the last time that you really paused? When was the last time that you turned everything off? When you stopped focusing and living and dwelling in all that was going around and set yourself, fixed your attention, your mind on God. It's why the power of habits or disciplines like silence, solitude, Sabbath as a weekly pause, prayer, rest, delight, celebration are so important in our life living like Jesus. You see, if Jesus needed to pause to live the life that he lived, who are we to think that we can ever live like Jesus without pausing, without becoming aware of God, without inviting God's presence and setting our mind on it? I've found this time and time again. And my challenge for you this week is to think about, take some time when this worship service is over and think about where in your week you can intentionally put pauses. Because there's this power in structuring in regular pauses that allows us to focus in a way that allows us to experience the presence of God with us. I found this a few years back. You know, I had my morning prayer devotional, but sometimes I would rush through it. Sometimes I would take a lot of time with it. Sometimes I would really feel it and feel it. Sometimes it would just be something I did, but it didn't matter how good that morning prayer time was. Often by mid-morning, I had lost that sense of abiding. And so since then, I've tried to figure out ways throughout the day where I can practice a pause. One is breath prayers, and I'm going to encourage you at the end that we're going to all pray a breath prayer, the same breath prayer, for the next 3 weeks together. Others have been things like putting in an intentional time in midday at lunch, somewhere from 2 to 10 minutes, to simply pray and pause. Another has been putting sometimes a prayer time in the evening to pause again. And what I've found as I practice these things, breath prayers that can be done in a few seconds whenever you get a moment to think, or a midday prayer, is that sometimes those pauses aren't just about the pause itself, it's about the way that the pause allows you to experience and be aware of God's presence and God's perspective through the rest of the day. I've noticed this in the life of others, and if you don't have intentional times of pausing worked into your day or your life, I encourage you to start wherever you are. It can be intimidating at first to be silent and still before God. And so you kind of have to find and experiment with the things that work for you. I knew a friend at the last church that I had. The leadership council at that time had some big decisions to make, and so they decided they would text each other every day at 12:30 and pray. And originally it was praying for specific results or outcomes, but over time, this 12:30 prayer time simply became a reminder on his phone, and that goes off every day at 12:30. And sometimes he pauses for 30 seconds, sometimes he pauses for 5 minutes, but he said that just reminder, that alarm on his phone every day at 12:30 has become something that just reminds him to pause however long and remember that he's not alone and to trust himself to abiding in God. Another friend of mine had always had trouble finding a regular time to be able to pray or to read scripture. And so he found actually that he was a small business owner, and he found that actually what worked for him is he, at home, he could never feel like he got peace. He would drive to work, and he was always to work early. And he would sit in his truck outside of his work. He had his Bible on the seat of his truck, and he'd read one chapter, and he'd pray, and he'd take 10 minutes every day. And he said it was for the first time in his life, it was in that truck sitting outside of work for 10 minutes, that he found his place, that he could practice a pause. And those pauses changed the way that he experienced God's presence throughout the whole rest of the day. All of this practice into the pause is something that we grow into. To learn to truly pray without ceasing the way that Paul did is something that takes years and years of practice. It's something that we grow into slowly over time, but it begins very small by making a decision in our week to practice the pause. One of the most important pauses that I have in my weekly rhythm is that of Sabbath. I take a Sabbath every Friday. It's a 24-hour period, 1 in 7, in which I rest and delight. And I have found over the last month in ministry and life that I have noticed the power of this, that my sense of peace and awareness and being who I am and being aware of God's presence. From the beginning of that Sabbath, I feel restless and kind of unsettled and frustrated. And by the end of the day, God almost always gives me the gift of the rest of my soul. How are you practicing the pause? And how might you find a way to put a small pause in your own life? Because I believe, just like Jesus was those first disciples, that he says, get ready, get set, pause. I believe that one of the most important things that we can do in this world in which life seems so overwhelming is find ways to pause and to step away, to breathe and to live and dwell in the presence of God alone, and to put those other things out of the way. One of the ways that I've found, as I said, is a breath prayer, and I'm encouraging us to all to memorize and pray this breath prayer that's an adaptation from Psalm 62 throughout this sermon series. And it says this way, in Christ alone, my soul finds rest. In Christ alone, my soul finds rest. And we put together this week so that you could remember this. I wonder if you could see this in the camera here. We put together this week at the church a kind of image that you can download from the website. It has the sermon series and it has that breath prayer on it. So I have it on my lock screen. I want to invite you to download this as your lock screen so that in the moments as you go through the day over the next 3 weeks, whenever you turn on your phone, you might be reminded to pray this prayer. It really only takes, right, like 10 seconds. But it's a way to practice the pause with your breathing. In Christ alone, my soul finds rest. Jesus never intended us to do this life alone. Jesus never intended us to live and dwell always in the mess and the hardness that only brings fatigue. Jesus invites us to practice the pause. And to find the truth the psalmist knew, that in the presence of God is rest for our souls. In the presence of God is fullness of life. In the presence of God, he will show us the path that leads to life. In the presence and in the pause comes the power. Jesus promises that we can abide in God's presence and he will abide in us. And one of the most powerful things that we can do is practice the pause. I want to invite you, as we finish the sermon today, to simply pray this breath prayer with me. In Christ alone, my soul finds rest. 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 God, may we be people who learn to live like Jesus. May we be people who learn those habits and those virtuous cycles that he practiced in his own life. Among those to practice the pause. And as we pause, may we find that in our lives, that we dwell ever more fully in your presence. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. I hope that this week that you find ways to practice the pause and you join me in praying that breath prayer. And as you go out today, just a reminder that you can find ways to give online. Thank you for all of you who have so generously continued to support the ministries of the church. And you can find ways to sign up for our sneak peek that's coming up on August 23rd. I look forward to continuing to get to know you and to joining you in worship. And I pray this week that as you practice the pause, that you may find the presence of God that fills you with life. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you this day and always. Go in peace, my friends. Have an awesome week.